Well, I think I've been a big believer since the start about mentoring people, particularly in the restaurants. You know, you have to train people and you have to teach people. They can't expect to do something that they don't know. So I guess that's really the start. I moved here to take over Commander's Palace in late 82, opened Emeralds in 1990. So Emeralds is getting ready to have another big celebration. It's kind of, for me, been a great journey, particularly the first 32 years, but now, you know, you can't rest on laurels. And so we've totally redefined Emeralds. Really, guys? Yeah.
Because that's great.
Hey, Jen? Ask them if they could make a little bit more noise back there in the kitchen. So I think, you can't rest on laurels. And so, you know, we've totally redefined Emeralds. We have another renovation planned this next summer. We continue to every day try to do a little bit better than the day before. And that's really that's the philosophy of mine. Now EJ's sort of come into play. So he's graduated and he's back from Europe and he's well-trained. He's got some good training. Besides growing up in the business, you know, he's worked with Eric Repair, he's worked at Frankton, he's worked at Core. He's really got some really... So he and the team here are really just sort of working together with me and really sort of making it better. And we're trying to do the same thing. You know, we're working a lot of new dishes right now at Merrill. And as I continue, you know, when the pandemic hit, it was really kind of shocking, you know, for everybody. But in the restaurant business, nobody was going out, nobody was eating, nobody was giving you a break on rent, et cetera. So insurance, you know, all those things still had to be paid. So we closed a total of five restaurants, actually seven restaurants, because we closed three in Pennsylvania, which was really sort of a licensing project. But we closed two in Las Vegas, and we closed two here in New Orleans. And when people ask me why, A, obviously money, and B, more importantly, you can't get the staff. You can't get the people. And it's not only can you get the people to work for you, you can't get the people to come in to eat in the restaurant because a lot of people are gone. And now, of course, with, you know, what's happening in the economy and all that stuff, it's really, the restaurant business become really, really challenging. I'm not going to say difficult. It's just become very, very challenging in a lot of sense with products, with goods, with timing. You know, we just kind of had to sit around in a round table and just say, okay, look, guys, gals, this is where we are, and this is certainly where we want to be. So how are we going to get there? What's the best way that we're going to get there? And when I look at the foundation, I say the same thing to myself. We're 20 years this year. We've impacted a lot of youth. We've mentored a lot of youth. We've done a lot of fantastic projects, continuing to keep doing more fantastic projects, based a lot here in New Orleans, but we've expanded also outside of New Orleans now. We're in Texas, we're in California, soon to be North Carolina, we're in Orlando, and we're making impact not only here locally, but we're making impact. And what's interesting, Chris, is that those roads sort of cross, you know, so... You know, we sort of get a little bit of Orlando that comes to New Orleans and a little New Orleans that goes to Orlando. And it's like a big circle of education and mentoring.
Fantastic.
So, yeah.
When you referenced the foundation 20 years ago, was this the vision? And to see it play out?
Yeah,
sure,
Alden.
There have been a lot of successes, a lot of challenges along the way.
Yeah, Alden and I, you know, we were really inspired, really, in the beginning by Andre Agassi, who's a friend. And I served on Andre's board for a long time, and seeing what Andre did on a much different level, much different scale. He built a school in Las Vegas where he lives. And to just see his enthusiasm and to see people around him and him using a talent of playing and being an excellent tennis player and doing that and using that to mentor youth. And I was like, wow, this is really phenomenal. And so Alden and I decided 21 years ago that, you know, we need to do something in New Orleans. You know, nothing is going to happen for the future if people don't make things happen for the future. And they are the future. So, they're the future leaders of tomorrow, you know. So we began the foundation, and we started very small, obviously, with St. Michael's, and then it was Cafe Reconcile. It sort of grew, and now it's really blown up here in New Orleans. We have, you know, we're involved with Nochi, but we built Noka. You know, we have Liberty's Kitchen. We have Edible Schoolyards. We have, you know, we're doing a really cool thing in Belchase at the military base there. Then we went outside. The first project we did was really in Orlando, and we built, a teaching kitchen garden there, very successful. So we mirrored that, and then we just kept. But we don't just, it's a process. We don't just say, okay, here you go. There's a criteria that has to be met. And we hired some very talented people. First of all, Brian Kish, who's my president. We surrounded ourselves with really some awesome people, some great people, big thinkers. And you got to think big if you're going to be big. So, you know, that's the bottom line. And we hired this young lady. She really oversaw writing the curriculum and how that was going to meet. And we went to my alma mater, Johnson & Wales. We got a lot of academic criteria from them. We used a lot of what's happening in New Orleans. And, you know, and we just learned from a lot of people. And we put together our own puzzle. And then we just kind of branched out. And so, like I said, now we're growing, but not fast. We're not, that's not the idea is to, more the merrier, as they say. That's not the case. We're very particular about where we're going, who we're with, who we're partnering with, and their responsibilities as well, because it's not like an open checkbook where it's like, okay, here you go, have a good time. You know, there has to be a responsibility on both parts.
When you visit some of these culinary gardens and teaching kitchens, and if you do have a chance to interact with the next generation, the younger students, and just seeing their faces light up, how does that make you feel? What does that mean to you?
Well, I think you got a taste of that this morning, right?
It's so amazing.
So that's the thing. When you see these young people, no matter what age, but, you know, today, obviously, they were pretty young students, right? And to see them understanding that, I'll never forget, Chris, that we had, Alden and I had some kids over when our kids were much little, and they came over, and we didn't celebrate New Year's Eve this particular year. We decided to be the babysitter, so we had all the kids, and all the parents went out, and we had all the kids at our house. And I'll never forget, we got up New Year's Day, and I made breakfast for the kids, but we took EJ's little wagon, and we had a couple of orange trees in the backyard, and we went, and we harvested some oranges with these kids, and they were, their mouths were just open, like they were like they couldn't believe this. We came inside, we sterilized the oranges, and we squeezed fresh orange juice, and everybody had fresh orange juice, and a couple of days goes by, and I get a call from one of the grandfathers, and he says, I really want to thank you what you did for my grandchildren. And I said, what do you mean? He said, well, they now know that orange juice comes from a tree and not from a carton. And it's like, it's so true. There it is right there. And to see these young people who take these seeds and then understand that by nurturing them and planting them and taking care of them, that something happens. That's called food. And then you take that food and then you have to do something with it, and you encourage the family. And then you encourage the family table. And so this process, it's really, really rewarding for me to see that and to see these young people. And it's the same thing to see some of these young people. Like, I just went in the kitchen to say good morning to everybody. And Janae is in the kitchen. And Janae is one of our She's one of our rock stars. She's one of the beginning students that we mentored, and then she did great, and then she got a scholarship to Johnson & Wales, and then she did great, and then now she's coming back here, and she's on a track now, probably not long, being, you know, one of our sous chefs in our organization, you know. It's really amazing.
And with that example in mind, and at the top you mentioned mentoring and how key that is to you, reflecting on that to help educate, inspire, and teach this next generation. Is it something that you think about over time, or is it over the course of a lifetime? You say, it's my duty now to kind of pass it on.
Well, it's, you know, there are a lot of people involved that are really helping Brian and I. Like I said, we have an awesome team, and that team continues to grow. But then under the core of that team, the outreach of that, you know, whether it's our chefs or sous chefs or sommelier or managers mm-hmm. or our wait staff, you know, to want to take those people in and understand what the vision is that we're trying to do, and to take that in and help mentor as well, it's really a great thing. And if you think about it, you know, we have to do that every day in the restaurant, you know. You know, I look at what we're doing right now at Emeralds. I look at what we're doing at Merrill Steakhouse in Las Vegas. We have to mentor every day our staff, because if not, it's like I said earlier, then stagnation becomes, you know, really gets in there. You know, it's kind of like a disease, and you try to avoid that. So you have to keep it interesting. You got to keep it educational. You got to keep mentoring and keep, you know, so little things like still our pre-meals that we do, our post-meals that we do, our meetings that we have with the foundation team and our board. We have a great board of directors and support board as well. All of those little things, you know, add up to make it a big thing.
And with the next generation, family generations as well, and keeping the tradition going, what's it like to have EJ and other family members involved in the industry and culinary and finding their own path?
My daughters are a little bit involved. My younger daughter is getting a little bit more involved. EJ's very involved. He is probably within a matter of time going to be some sort of part of the board. Or he has really fresh ideas and great ideas. And it's the same thing like with my chefs here and with EJ and Chef Chris and Dave, our culinary director, and Tim, our creative director. You know, we're all working together to make tomorrow better. In order to do that, you have to make today better. So,
that's great. When you cook alongside your son, though, do you take some time just to say,
we have two
special?
Yeah, we have two different styles. It is very, very special, but we have two very different styles. You know, so, you know, I'm from the old school, and yeah. I, you know, I'm very technique driven and flavor driven, and you know, he is very today modern. Probably more classically inspired, you know, French inspired. You know, he's worked at some really amazing places. So, you know, those things to see after he spends time in those places, what he brings back and what he's added to his foundation of knowledge, that's what's really, it's amazing. Because, you know, they play off of each other. You know, the pastry chef plays off of the chef, and the chef is playing off of the culinary director, and then they're relying on, you know, with EJ, and then, you know, it's really a process. It's a process worth to see.
All in concert together.
Yes, absolutely. Exactly. That's exactly right. You look at it, it's just a big symphony, but in order to do that, you got to have a well-tuned orchestra.
That's a great line. How busy is life these days? You know,
it's busy.
You know, you still have your hand in a lot of different projects.
Well, I just got done shooting two shows for Roku, a tailgating show, which is airing right now. You can stream it. A cooking show that debuts the end of this month. That was really exciting to get back and doing that and having guests and really being in a situation to teach again, you know, to just kind of about food. It's a cooking show. It's, you know, it's not... it's not a competition. It's not, you know, we're not throwing dots at each other. It's just, you know, it's a cooking show. And so that's been really good. We got a couple of projects on, you know, on the baseline that we're working on, and it doesn't stop. So it's just like, but more importantly, the refinement here at Emeralds, what we're working on at Merrill, we're bringing, you know, we hit a wall with the pandemic, particularly at Merrill. We hit a big wall. And so we had to dissect a lot of things because, you know, when you go from 28 people in the kitchen to 16 people in the kitchen, there's only certain amount of things that you can do. So we really had to shave a lot and cut back a lot. And that didn't really make me happy. So now we're in a process where we're building that again, and we're working on a lot of new dishes and expanding the menu slowly. You know, adding our hours of operation slowly. And that's the thing today. You can't run too fast because you may get tripped up, you know, in today's time.
In a sense, and we mentioned it's a challenge, not necessarily overly difficult, but a new challenge. Does that give you a new kind of maybe fight, a new spirit, a new passion to say, hey,
yeah,
we are working together to overcome something completely different, which was the pandemic,
yeah,
the aftermath of it all?
Yeah, so like when I walk into these, into our kitchens now, you know, like it's like, you know, it's like I got to push myself as well, you know, because, you know, these guys are running hard, and in today's time, with what they have access to so quickly with technology, right? You got to be fast on your feet, and these guys are fast. And so, you know, I walk into the steakhouse, and it's like the chef and the team there, and it's like, wow, these guys are moving fast, you know. Even though that we're you know, we're still got our philosophy of over 20 years about how we handle meat and age meat, et cetera, we're still running fast. And it's the same thing with the fish house. It's like I said, it's the same thing at Merrill. It may seem like the pace is calm, but really internally, it's you know, we're moving fast.
Right. Anytime you come to visit or you just feel back at home when you're here, is there something you've got to eat? Is there something you've got to prepare to kind of really truly feel at home?
Yeah, well, you know, I love seafood. I love, you know, fish. So there's obvious places around town for that, whether that's old school or new school. I'm a huge Vietnamese cuisine fan, so I eat a lot of Vietnamese food when I can, a couple of times a week. There's some really amazing Vietnamese food here in the city. And I'm just proud to, you know, to be a part of it. So, like I said, you know, we're going to try a little bit harder today than we did yesterday, and hopefully make tomorrow better.
The New Orleans culinary scene, obviously world class, and so many great institutions, both iconic and new school as well. What have you seen maybe as the biggest shift? And we mentioned the up-tempo with technology, but is there a different perspective, or is it an age-old tradition that continues to hold true that New Orleans is some of the best food in the world?
I think there's some really, well, first of all, yes, New Orleans definitely is one of the top cities for cuisine in the world. There's no doubt about that. But what I'm seeing is that, you know, for years, you know, we had really great critics, right, that were helpful critics, you know, that reviewed food in restaurants, but were helpful. They weren't destroyable, you know, for the most part. And, you know, you go back to, you know, Tom Fitzmaurice and Gene Borg, and I could go on and on and on. And now you see today's time, especially after the pandemic, you know, you got guys like Ian McNulty, who I think is a phenomenal, not only a writer, but a human being, who is trying to help restaurants and not destroy them, right? So I think now the biggest thing for the city is that, for being such a great food city as we really are, we don't have a Michelin guide here. But we have a Michelin guide in New York. We have a Michelin guide in Chicago, in this country. In Europe, it's everywhere, right? Pretty much so. People live by that. I mean, people live by either the app or by the Michelin guidebook when they're going to go visit a city. Miami and up to Orlando just were recent. So I think the next big challenge for New Orleans is that I foresee that we will be, finally, we will be a city very soon to have a Michelin guide, a Michelin rated restaurants. And we in America, some cities really just reflect on those things, and really they count. It really, you know, when I travel, I go get a Michelin guide. I have it on an app. So if I'm going to London, if I'm going to Paris, if I'm going to Chicago, New York, Northern California, Southern California, Chicago, New York, Washington, Miami, Orlando now are the states, cities that have the Michelin guide. I predict that's going to expand in America soon. I wouldn't be surprised about Boston. Like I said, New Orleans is due for it because it's such a great, great American food city. So we'll see what happens.
Very good. Also looking ahead, next weekend's a very special showcase.
Next week is...
You want to walk us through all the fun?
Yeah, next week is just a total special 20th anniversary Boudin, sort of a lighter Boudin. We used to really have a huge Boudin in beer. We've toned it down a little bit since the pandemic. Carnival de Vin next Saturday night will be very, very special, the 20th anniversary. I'm really looking forward to the kids at NOCA have designed the menu. So I'm really looking forward to that dinner and just the festivities and seeing a lot of great people and supporters. You know, Chris, when it comes down to it, you know, without people like you and people that attend this, it wouldn't be possible to do what we do. What we do is because of people like you and people like that that are coming and supporting the foundation. Whether it's $50 or it's $500,000, it's all part of the, you know, all part of the secret.
You seem as busy as ever, which is a great thing. How do you kind of view this life right now? I mean, do you feel like it takes new opportunities? It's a new world.
I have some colleagues that, you know, are close in age or, you know, whatever, and they're like talking about retirement and this and this and that. That's not in my vocabulary, so we'll see.